Today we begin a commentary on the book of Amos. It is one of the minor prophets, of course, minor in size, not in importance. But Amos prophesied to, specifically, and about, the northern house of Israel. Of course, the northern 10 tribes, not the specifically to Judah, though Judah is addressed in the prophecy only to a minor degree, because, again, God saw fit to use other prophets to prophesy to them and what was going to happen to them, not only in the near future for them at the time, but very far into the far future that's still yet in the future, even as we address this subject today in 2023. Now, Amos prophesied around 753 BC. Again, we always like to throw those in there so we kind of can get an idea of when he's prophesying and what's going to happen, because we know that Israel went into captivity around 721 to 718 BC. And then much later, Judah went into captivity. But we always look for these telltale signs, though, that show that it's not just a prophecy for that time, but a prophecy for the future, because we know that one of the mechanisms in prophecy and one of the keys to understanding it is the duality of prophecy, meaning that not only does it happen once back in ancient times, and of course it would have been futuristic times for those who were hearing the message, but also is still in the future for us today in terms of the fact that these things are going to come around again. I know we like to say that history has a tendency to repeat itself if you don't learn, and that would be the case here, because Israel and of course Judah have not learned the lessons of the past, nor the lessons of the Bible, or the lessons of prophecy. Now, Amos came from a little town of Tekoa in the area of Judah, the southern part of modern-day Israel, which is about 10 miles to the south of Jerusalem. And he was a sheep breeder. And the only other place that this word is found in the Bible is in 2 Kings 3:4, where it was talking about Mesha, king of Moab, was a sheep breeder. So that's about all we know. Amos 7 verses 14 and 15 also talk about Amos being a sheep breeder, though it's a different word there. I think it's something like he was a tender of cattle, as it were. And the problem with that is that, okay, that was not actually the word, and we can kind of get confused on this, but this is what happens in the Bible sometimes whenever they borrow the intended term or what was implied. A lot of times we'll see that in italics. But nonetheless, he was a sheep breeder, he was a tender of the sheep, and he had other little side jobs as well that he did. But we just bring this out to say, okay, this is the way God was, quote-unquote, training Amos. This is the way he was bringing him up. This is the way that he prepared him, quote-unquote, for the job that he had ahead. It wasn't that he had to be the smartest, the strongest, the best in anything, per se, but God had a purpose for him, no doubt from the beginning, saw fit that he was going to, again, be trained in this way to do this. And again, he addresses this a little bit later, and we'll talk about it. But it's very likely that Amos was not well off because of the nature of a job, and it appears that he by himself could take care of and manage the flock because it wasn't too large. So he also had this little side job I was talking about. He was a tender of sycamore fruit there in Amos 7:14. And it was not a very illustrious type of resume, but this is who God chose. And we know that God does not always choose the mighty, the wise, the noble, as 1 Corinthians 1 talks about. But he chooses these other things to confound the mighty, to put them to shame. And most importantly, I think, to show God working through this person. The person is nothing in and of themselves without God in them, God speaking through them, God's message coming through them. This is not coming from Amos himself. It is going through Amos. Amos is merely a messenger. And so we see that Amos, again, takes place around the time of Jeroboam II. He was the son and successor of Jehoash, the 14th king of Israel, who ruled for, I think it was something like 41 years in 825 to 784 BC. And he, here's the problem, followed the example of the first Jeroboam in keeping up with the worship of golden calves. Again, I'll put all these scriptures online if you care to look them up and go a little bit more into the history. But what we're seeing here is a pattern of idolatry, a pattern of false worship, a pattern of ignoring God, his ways, and what they were told and what they agreed to live by, the words of God. So it was during the reign of Amaziah and Uzziah, who were the kings of Judah. So you have both of them ruling separately. When they split off, again, Jeroboam set the nation, or the kingdom, I should say, the tribes, the northern 10 tribes of Israel, off on the wrong path. And this is what, part and parcel of what Amos was going to be dealing with. Now, during these times, and here's a hard part, and it's also, I think, a lesson for us today, for America today, is that during this time of Jeroboam, there was this incredible time of prosperity of 41 years. It was probably the most prosperous that Israel had ever known. They extended the limits of their territories, and they had this outward prosperity. Yet inwardly, they were corrupt, and iniquity prevailed. And this is the problem. And of course, God doesn't care about the prosperity. It's nothing compared to what he has to offer or what he can even give us today. So, of course, Amos was tasked with this message to give to Israel to try to help them get back on track or have to deal with the ensuing punishment. So we have also, just by way of note, that Hosea, Joel, and Jonah all look like they lived during the reign of this time in Israel. So let's begin now in chapter 1. Chapter 1 of Amos, Amos 1 and verse 1. The words of Amos, who was among the sheep breeders of Tekoa, which he saw concerning Israel in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah, and in the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel, 2 years before the earthquake. So Amos's prophecy is dated to a time of this 2 years before the earthquake. And again, historical sources put that around 751 BC is when the earthquake was. And that's the way that we came up with the 753 BC. Also, you might put Zechariah 14:5 in your notes. It refers to the earthquake as well in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. Now, Amos went to Bethel, the house of God, from Tekoa to give God's message. And then, from everything we understand, he promptly returned home. He probably stayed there for only a few days. And so this was a very, very short appearance of Amos on the scene and then coming off the scene. He got in there, God's message, after, you know, tending the sheep and everything, and came back and no doubt went right back to what he was doing. So when he goes in there and he makes his prophecy and this appearance at Bethel, Jeroboam II ends up dying. And this time of great prosperity, which again coincides with Amos's pronouncements, begins to rapidly decline. So we see a very realistic case of cause and effect, that God's giving a message, they don't follow it, and so then the effect happens. So continuing in verse 2, it says, "And he said, the Lord roars from Zion and utters his voice from Jerusalem. The pastures of the shepherds mourn, and the top of Carmel withers." So again, we see Amos delivering a message, but it's backed by God. So even though Amos comes as this quote-unquote lowly shepherd or sheep herder, sheep breeder, and he comes up to the area of Bethel, and yet he's this unassuming person, it is backed by God, who is going to then make sure that the people understand that it was indeed him that the message was really from, and his power and the results and the cause, he is the cause, and the effects that are going to follow are indeed going to speak very loudly. Indeed, they are coming from him. So now we begin, now for the rest of this chapter, these pronouncements of on, I would say, different cities in the area, in the region. And he's very specific, and he begins with Damascus here in verses 3 through 5 of Amos 1. So in verse 3, he says, "Thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Damascus, and for four, I will not turn away its punishment, because they have threshed Gilead with implements of iron." So the first thing that we need to address, and we're going to see this several more times in this one chapter alone, and it talks about for three transgressions and for four. Now, this is an idiomatic phrase. It means if it had only been perhaps once or twice, then maybe we could have dealt with that. Maybe we could have, you know, had you repent and we said, okay, we understand that these are just the foibles of humans, the frailty, where they do slip up from time to time. But the reality is that it has not been just three or four, but many sins, many times, many iniquities and wickedness. And this is the justification of this impending correction from God. So for three transgressions and for four, okay, it's gone on for too long, and now it's time to do something about it. So because of this, God says, "I will not turn away." He says, "I will no longer stop myself from doing what needs to be done. I'm not going to reverse this punishment." And he's going to bring it on Damascus now. Now, Damascus was the capital of Syria. And I think, you know, I think you should just go and look at a map of the region to figure out where everything is in this region. So I would go look at it where Syria is, and of course that's Damascus, and Lebanon, and Gaza, and Jordan, and Gilead, and a whole bunch of these places, and start to put them together, at least visualize them, so you see who it is, what's happening, the directions, and that they're all not really that far apart. And furthermore, there's a long history of these people with the Israelites and the people of that land where God had put his people. And of course, they didn't completely understand. There were always going to be some conflicts along this line, especially since these were not godly people and they didn't understand it. And they didn't believe necessarily, sometimes they did, in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But what we have in Damascus is one of Israel's long-time enemies. And they were ones that could be very, very cruel at times, too. In 2 Kings 8, verses 12 and 13, again, 2 Kings chapter 8, verses 12 and 13, we see, again, a little instance of this. It says, "And Hazael said, 'Why is my Lord weeping?' And he answered, 'Because I know the evil that you will do to the children of Israel. Their strongholds you will set on fire, and their young men you will kill with the sword, and you will dash their children and rip open their women with child.' So Hazael said, 'But what is your servant, a dog, that he should do this gross thing?' And Elisha answered, 'The Lord has shown me that you will become king over Syria.'" And you can go read that whole story there in 2 Kings 8. But it was Ben-Hadad that was the king, and Hazael was not. But yet Ben-Hadad was sick at the time. And so he, again, took advantage of the situation and Elisha, the prophet's words about this. But the other point here to make is that even at the time, Hazael, who was not yet king, thought that this was a horrendous thing to do, to rip open the women with child. He thought it was gross and it would be completely out of character for somebody to do, yet he ends up doing it. Not only him, but it seemed to be a practice in the area. So going back to Amos 1, verse 3, again, he's talking about what they had done in Gilead. Now, Gilead was this region that was east of the Jordan River, roughly between the Sea of Galilee and the Dead Sea. So the Jordan River connected those two, and the land to the east of that was called Gilead, and it was originally it encompassed part of modern-day Jordan. But they threshed Gilead with implements of iron. And you may want to put just 2 Kings 13, 7 in your notes, but it does talk about the king of Syria and the people being threshed by them, or a threshing happening. But nonetheless, you know, and I should say this as a caveat, and we always do, is that whether we know exactly, you know, what it's talking about, or who it's talking about, or when it's talking about, we know that it has happened or it will happen. And we just know that we can take these things as absolute when we understand them, again, the way that they were originally put down in, as scripture, as then later put together and canonized as the Bible. But nonetheless, they threshed Gilead with implements of iron. So that being the case, they nearly obliterated Israel, and they were no doubt inhumane and subjected them to cruel, unusual punishment. And that this is why God is making this prophecy against them and saying, okay, because of this, okay, such and such will happen. Verse 4, we see some of what's going to happen. He says, but I will send a fire into the house of Hazael, which shall devour the palaces of Ben-Hadad, the one that we were talking about before, and that Hazael had killed. Again, you saw that, and we could see that in 2 Kings 8 and verse 15. And again, I would recommend in your time as you go through and study and understand this to go back and read that 2 Kings 8. And it helps just to put a lot of these things together. But note what he says. He says, I'm going to send a fire. Okay, now this happens to all of the people that are being prophesied against, all the cities, again, the people behind it, that God is going to send a fire. And it seems to be the same one because, again, as we're going to see here, okay, this is kind of what I was alluding to as well, is that it's not apparent as we go through all these prophecies that they actually ever happened in the past, which obviously puts them in the future. And there'll be one in particular that it's pretty obvious that it never happened in the past. So the nature of these is perhaps it may have had a primary fulfillment back in ancient times, but the setting for a lot of this and most of this is in the future and most likely during the day of the Lord. So we're going to go throughout this chapter, verses 7, 10, 12, 14, and even into chapter 2, verses 2 and 5, that we see that God sends a fire. So this could be, again, this part of the seven trumpets talk about fire during the day of the Lord. But we're going to discuss what this interpretation means a little bit later in the chapter. So again, he's going to send this fire, and it's going to devour the palaces. Again, the palaces, the seats of power and authority are going to come to naught. And we'll see just how completely some of these things will happen yet in the future when God gets involved. So back to Amos 1 and verse 5 now. It says, I will also break the gate bar of Damascus and cut off the inhabitant from the valley of Avon, and the one who holds the scepter from Beth Eden. The people of Syria shall go captive to Kir, says the Lord. All right, so the word here then for Beth Avon may mean of an idol, okay? So it's thought to be a place where idols were worshipped by the Syrians. Their gods were the gods of the valley, and of course they denied the God of Israel and who he was going to be. In 1 Kings 20, verse 23, 1 Kings 20, verse 23 says, then the servants of the king of Syria said to him, their gods are gods of the hills. Okay, so again, looking, it's using little g's, right, to emphasize that we're not talking about the real one and only God here. Therefore, they were stronger than we, but if we fight against them in the plain, surely we will be stronger than they. Now, we've talked about this once before, about the Valley of Avon or Beth Avon in Hosea 4 and verse 15. Hosea 4 and verse 15 says, though you, Israel, play the harlot, let not Judah offend. Do not come up to Gilgal, nor go up to Beth Avon, nor swear an oath, saying, as the Lord lives. So again, we talked about Beth Avon being the house of vanity or iniquity, is the literal translation. So again, whether it's idols or vanity, again, same thing. You know, the worship of sticks and stones is a worship that is vain or a vanity. So again, Hosea 10 verse 8 and 10 verse 5 talked about it. We talked about it a little bit more just for a reference if you want to go back and have a look at it. So now, continuing on in verse 5, we talk about the people of Syria shall go captive to Kir. Okay, I think it's Kir, not Kir, but K-I-R, go to Kir. So in 2 Kings 16, verses 7 through 9, in 2 Kings 16, verses 7 through 9, we see a primary fulfillment in ancient times of this happening, right? So this is what we're talking about, is that, yes, it could have happened back in ancient times. And in, this seems to be the case here with this. In 2 Kings 16, verse 7, it says, so Ahaz, now Ahaz was one of the kings of Judah, sent messengers to Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria, all right? Not Syria, but Assyria, saying, I am your servant and your son. Come up and save me from the hand of the king of Syria and from the hand of the king of Israel who rise up against me. And so Ahaz took the silver and gold that was found in the house of the Lord and in the treasuries of the king's house and sent it as a present to the king of Assyria. So the king of Assyria heeded him, for the king of Assyria went up against Damascus and took it and carried its people captive to Kir, and killed Rezin. And so that happened around 740 BC. So approximately another 13 years later, this prophecy was fulfilled in this sense, but not fully. Now, Kir is part of Moab. It's parts of Jordan and Western Iraq, and Josephus, for historical reference, puts it as far as Upper Media. Okay, media, when we say media, it's like Medes and Persians, media. So that's up in northwest Iran today, the Azerbaijan-Armenia area up there, if you want to go look at that on the map. And, of course, Iran was the land of the Medes and the Persians. So whenever you see the land of the Medes and the Persians, Iran still identifies as Persians today. So in Isaiah 15... in verse 1, again, we're just talking about identifying where Kir is and what Kir is. Isaiah 15:1 says, the burden against Moab, because in the might of Ar of Moab is laid waste and destroyed, because in the night Kir of Moab is laid waste and destroyed. So again, it's half art, half science here in trying to figure out who's who in the Bible. And when we do it, we kind of give it our best guess. But also part of this is that these peoples move around as well. So while they may have been located at this point one time as a people, they may have migrated to someplace else. And so then they identify in the future from a different region. And again, we'll see that a little bit later. So what we see here then is that that Tiglath-Pileser, this Assyrian ruler at the time, fulfilled this prophecy when Ahaz applied to him for help against Rezin, who is the king of Syria, and he carried away the Syrian people captive. Now, near the end of the book of Amos, it shows God delivering the Syrians from Kir. All right, so Amos 9 and verse 7, you can put that there, and it shows then that God does this. And so what we see here is that God continues to deal with his people and deal with the nations around them. Again, this is the only way that prophecy can come about, that prophecy can be fulfilled, is if God is in charge. God, who is influencing and allowing men to do this or not allowing them to do that, to bring about what's going to happen. Because again, he knows our human nature well enough to see these things. But he also wants all men to be saved. He does these things as a punishment. God has the power to bring people back to life, and he will and does do that, and will do that in the future as well. So again, it's not that he's a wrathful God, but he's a God that will punish. He will get people's attention, Because in the long run, the character that the people build, they're changing from their old ways to the new ways. It was is what God is most interested in and what is most important to him and that he's going to bring to fruition. So now back to Amos 1 in verses 6 through 8. Now we deal with Gaza. Okay, so in Amos 1 in verse 6, it says, "Thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Gaza, and for four, I will not turn away its punishment, because they took captive the whole captivity to deliver them up to Edom." So Gaza is basically the same area where Gaza is today. And again, it's quite interesting that here it is. Amos is talking about this, you know, how long ago? Over 2,500 years ago. And he's saying these things about this future, about Gaza and what's going to happen in the future. Now, I'm not saying what's happening right now between Israel and Gaza after this, the attack by Gaza on Israel and the capturing of many of the Israelis and bringing them across the border. And now it continues to go on. But we see that they've always been a thorn in the side, continue to be a thorn in the side, and in the future will do these things that are going to require God to intervene in the very end time. But up until then, we see that Gaza, for one reason or the other, gets the upper hand here, and they are going to be, a thorn in the side of Israel. So now back to Gaza. Gaza was one of the five cities that make up the Pentapolis of Philistia, in other words, the five cities of Philistia. Okay, now three of the other ones are mentioned here in verse 8, and so there was only one that was left out. But this region of the Philistines is located in southwest Israel, where several of them still can be found today. So I think Gaza, though, is the only one that is actually found in the Gaza Strip, but the other of the five are made up in that area. And it says that they took captive the whole captivity. So everyone went into captivity. Now, by way of history, let's go back to 2 Chronicles 21. 2 Chronicles 21, verses 16 and 17. 2 Chronicles 21, verses 16 and 17. It says, "Moreover, the Lord stirred up against Jehoram." All right, so we see God's involvement in this. "So he stirred up against Jehoram the spirit of the Philistines and the Arabians who were near the Ethiopians. And they came up into Judah and invaded it and carried away all the possessions that were found in the king's house, and also his sons and his wives. So there was not a son left to him except for Jehoahaz, the youngest of his sons." And then a few chapters later, in chapter 28, verses 18 and 19, it says, "The Philistines also had invaded the cities of the lowland and of the south of Judah, and had taken Beth Shemesh and all these others with their villages, and they dwelt there. For the Lord brought Judah low because of Ahaz, king of Israel, for he had encouraged moral decline in Judah, and had been continually unfaithful to the Lord." So again, it really seems like it's written in 21st century type of English here, but it's exactly what happened. Because they continued to go the wrong direction, God intervened and said, okay, here's what's going to happen. We're going to, and he knew that they were going that direction, and he continued to warn them. And they just did not listen, to the point where, you know, he could no longer turn a blind eye to it. He could no longer allow them to continue in the way that they had been going. Like he says, you know, "I can no longer, you know, turn away." So, verse 7 says, "I will send a fire upon the wall of Gaza, which shall devour its palaces." All right, again, just hold on to that thought for a little bit more about the send a fire and devour. Right, we're going to address this a little bit later here to see exactly what that could mean. So in verse 8, he says, "I will cut off the inhabitant from Ashdod, and the one who holds his scepter from Ashkelon. I will turn my hand against Ekron, and the remnant of the Philistines shall perish, says the Lord God. So there we have, again, the other three cities I was talking about, all in that region. And I think the fifth one was Gath. And again, there are still cities in the area that all these were with these names, or at least remnants of these names, where, you know, they realized that this was a city in ancient times, the one that the Bible is referring to. So again, it was fulfilled at least in part in 2 Kings 18 and verse 7 and 8. 2 Kings 18 verses 7 and 8. But again, remember that all this stuff is more than likely dual. So they, while we do have the primary, we see that God works in duality. Okay, doesn't always have to. So these have been fulfilled. But when we start putting it together with the rest of the Bible and the rest of these prophecies, you see that a lot of these cities go hand in hand with each other anyway. 2 Kings 18, verses 7 and 8 says, "And the Lord was with him. He prospered wherever he went, and he rebelled against the king of Assyria and did not serve him. He subdued the Philistines as far as Gaza and its territory, from watchtower to fortified city." So we see then that, again, the Philistines were subdued as far as Gaza, and again, God turned his hand against them. So now continuing in verses 9 and 10, of Amos 1, we now come to Tyre. Now, Tyre was this major port city back in the day. Again, go look at where it is in modern-day Lebanon, right on the coast, located just north of Israel, and it's right there on the water. Anyway, we see here, again, when we start putting the Bible together, a little here and a little there, that Tyre is not just Tyre in Lebanon, on the coast. Notice in Ezekiel 27 verse 4, I can read this one to you. And again, this may be all old hat, but we just want to put a few things together. Is that in Ezekiel 27 verse 4, it says, "Your borders are in the midst of the seas. Your builders have perfected your beauty." Again, it's a prophecy about Tyre. But I want you to notice that it says your borders are in the midst of the seas. And now let's compare that with Revelation 17 verses 1 and 2. And we now are talking about Babylon. And notice what it talks about Babylon. It says in Revelation 17, verses 1 and 2, says, "Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with me, saying to me, 'Come, I will show you the judgment on the great harlot who sits on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth committed fornication. The inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication.'" So we have this in the midst of the seas, right? Italy, with its capital in Rome, is located in between and surrounded by several or numerous seas or oceans, whatever you want to call them. But you have the Ligurian, the Tyrrhenian, as in Tyre, Mediterranean, the Ionian, the Adriatic Sea. All these surround that area of Italy. So what we're seeing here is, and again, this is by way of quick review, of what we, I think, already know in terms of Tyre is, especially when we start looking at the Prince of Tyre and the King of Tyre, is that it is synonymous with Babylon in the end times. Now, interestingly enough, Tyre and Babylon, okay, Babylon is in Iraq, and Tyre is right there in Lebanon, that the peoples of those areas did not actually remain in those areas at the time they were being talked about in ancient times. So the Babylonians, the Medes, and the Persians go to battle, and the Medes and Persians subdue Babylon in 539 BC. And then what happened was that the Medes and the Persians used Babylon as one of their major cities in that region. Even though they conquered it and didn't necessarily live there, they still nonetheless kept it intact with the peoples there. Then Alexander the Great came in, right? So you have, again, we have the by way of review, the image of Daniel, you have, they had a goal, which is Babylon. Then you had the Medo-Persian, the Medes and the Persians. Then you had the Greco-Macedonians, Greeks, and then finally the Romans. But Alexander the Great was the next one, the Greek-Macedonian Empire. And he even made Babylon the capital of his region there. Okay. And then after Alexander the Great died, he divided it up between, I think it was his four generals, and Seleucid had that region, and he kept it as this main area for him, this central city. But he then moved it, his main city, to Seleucus. And the people of Babylon, he invited them to move up there to, it wasn't too far north as you know, we would consider it today, to move up to Seleucus. And Babylon as a city or as a nation state or a city state, as they called it, would never be the city of great influence ever again after the peoples moved to Seleucus. And then, okay, Seleucid then moved to Antioch, which is near modern day Turkey/Syria border. So we have Israel, then you have Lebanon where Tyre is, and then just north of that is Syria, and then you, just there to the north, you have the Syria-Turkey border, Antioch, which is where then it moved. And the people of the regions eventually moved there. They continued to migrate. And again, when you understand that people are in need of work and commerce, that they're going to go where the work is very often. And so we find that they continue to move along, and these people migrated, and also those in the region of Tyre. So Tyre, again, had its run-in with the Babylonians for 13 years, I think, and then also it was Alexander the Great who came, and I think the story is quite infamous, of how they had their little island fortress off the coast, and Alexander the Great built a causeway. He started dumping rocks and debris into the water so that he could then walk onto it and take over the island, which again didn't make him very happy, and he made them pay, and he brought a lot of them and took a lot of them into slavery. And over the years, again, Italy, now with Rome, and the Rome being the next empire, it had its people there, but again, because of different economic reasons, many people left the region and moved elsewhere. And so it kind of created this vacuum in Italy. And it was filled by slaves coming in, slaves from Tyre that would come in there as well. And so what happened then, these slaves were then freed and they remained in the area. And what we see then is that we have this confluence of Tyre and Babylon and Rome all coming together in the region. And we can see now that it was more than just, say, mere coincidence, or it's like it's taking this little bitty city over in Lebanon saying, okay, we're going to make this a symbol of Babylon in the future. You know, God was intimately involved in bringing all these people, and this is why they are so closely related in the Bible and often used interchangeably. So anyway, that was my very quick review, and hopefully you're able to follow along and know, but we've talked about this in the past, and hopefully that's enough. If not, you know, we may address it further in the future. Now, continuing on then, in Amos 1 and verse 9, it begins this prophecy against Tyre. So it says, "Thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Tyre and for four, I will not turn away its punishment, because they delivered up the whole captivity to Edom and did not remember the covenant of brotherhood." Again, so they were taking these captives, and they were more than willing to send them to Edom, probably in trade for money or for goods. And Edom obviously was more than willing to take them, as they did from Gaza in the previous verses, and as Edom would eventually take for themselves in the following verses. And during this, they did not remember the covenant of brotherhood. Now, there's nothing specifically mentioned in the Bible about a covenant of brotherhood between Israel and Tyre, right? So not sure exactly if this is between, we're talking about Israel and Tyre, or between Israel and Edom here in terms of the covenant of brotherhood, because obviously Israel and Edom are brothers. Israel was Jacob and Edom was Esau, and Jacob and Esau were twins who, as you know, were in conflict with each other from the very beginning. So it's not completely clear here who it's talking about in terms of the covenant of brotherhood, though it does, in my mind, seem to be leaning a little bit more towards Tyre and Israel, because everybody's delivering stuff up to Edom, and Edom's taking stuff on their own anyway, that it doesn't specifically have to be referring to Edom here, because you'll see, you know, as we saw with Gaza, sending the whole captivity to Edom, and Edom doing theirs, their part in all of this. But that being said, like I said, there was no mention of this covenant, this agreement between them. Now, that being said, they were pretty much the only people who never got into a fight with Israel. Everybody else around them did, except for Tyre. There was King Hiram, who was the king of Tyre at the time of David and Solomon. They had a really good relationship, and Hiram provided a lot of goods for to help build the temple. We call it the Temple of Solomon. It was God's temple at the time. So what we have then is, not only were they had perhaps this covenant of brotherhood where they enjoyed each other like brothers, but they never fought. So when we look at this, if that's the case, again, I can't find a case of it in the Bible or in history where these people of Phoenicia, the Phoenicians, the people of Tyre, ever fought with the people of Israel. And so this then would have to make it something that's in the future that has never happened in the past. So then that gives more credence to the book of Amos being a prophet. We know it's a prophecy and that he's a minor prophet, but that it's referring to the yet foreseeable future. And plus, now we also see that Tyre, being right there on the coast, this little bitty city, you're going, well, how could that little city have anything to do with taking Israel? Even now, you know, okay, it's not to say that things can't change, but Israel is one of the strongest militaries in the world. I think they're like fourth, fifth strongest. Again, a lot of that's because we've given them armament, but they stay ahead in terms of technology. And of course, they need it with all the surrounding region seeking to either destroy them or push them into the ocean, as we see in this most recent conflict with Gaza. So that, when we combine with the fact that Tyre is now specifically pointing to the people of the beast power in the future, and again, that's going to be up in Central Europe, is that, okay, yeah, this doesn't appear to have happened in any way, shape, or form, so it has to be still yet in the future. So then it goes on in verse 10, like it says of the others, I will send a fire upon the wall of Tyre, which shall devour its palaces. So again, there's no verifiable account of this as happening in the past. It didn't happen in the past. And we know that ancient Tyre was more or less eventually destroyed around 330 BC by Alexander the Great when he built that causeway. And again, there's no mention of fire at that time, though I think somebody else has said, oh yeah, well, the Babylonians came in and, you know, they shot, you know, arrows of fire or whatever. But again, Tyre continued to exist up until this point. And then they were never, ever a power to be reckoned with since that time, since Alexander the Great did what he did, up until recent history. So there is no verifiable, that's why I said verifiable. There's always going to be somebody that's going to say something, but there was nothing that would fulfill this prophecy. And Tyre was this major center of commerce in the ancient world. And it's also going to be that in the future. Again, We can go back, and again, I would recommend that you go back and read Ezekiel 27, and there's other prophecies about Tyre in terms of what's going to happen, that there's going to be an issue with them in the end, that they're going to have to be dealt with. And whenever you just look at Tyre today, you're going, well, that's not really the, you know, can be the problem. How can they? And again, Tyre's not the only city that's ever mentioned in Lebanon. There's talks about Sidon and others too. But again, it's talking about Tyre. And when we put the Bible together, you know, it does refer to this Babylonian system, which indeed is going to be very similar to what Tyre used to be in terms of this major area of commerce. You know, they were there on the seas. They ruled around this Mediterranean region, and they had tons of goods and unique, and they had wealth and whatnot. And this was going to happen with the Babylonian system as well in the future. And everybody's going to want to do business with them. And so, all that being said, the friendly relationship that Israel has always had with Tyre, with the Phoenicians, with these people, okay, is not going to be remembered by Tyre. Okay, and this is why God's going to come up against them in the very end. So then, verses 11 and 12, we have the prophecy against Edom. Now, he says, thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Edom, and for four, I will not turn away its punishment, because he pursued his brother with the sword and cast off all pity. His anger tore perpetually, and he kept his wrath forever. Again, the story of Jacob and Esau from the womb, right? There was this struggle. And they came out with Jacob holding his heel, meaning he would supplant him. But in Obadiah 1, in verse 10, and we'll go through a few verses here. Again, it talks about specifically the whole book, this prophecy against Edom, against Esau, against, again, not Jacob. So Jacob was God's people. Edom was, again, everybody else, especially in this region. And it says in Obadiah 1, I say 1, verse 10, or it's just Obadiah verse 10, only one chapter. For violence against your brother Jacob, shame shall cover you. You shall be cut off forever. So again, we see that the Edomites, okay, from the time, like I said, when they were kids, and again, Jacob did wrong by Esau a few times. But nonetheless, the Edomites have continued to escalate this between the two of them all the way till the very end. In verse 11, in the day that you stood on the other side, in the day that strangers carried captive his forces. Okay, again, let's tie that in our mind to Amos 1 and all these other peoples, right, who have had them captive and sold them back to, or, you know, delivered them back to Edom. Okay, this is what's happening. This is what's being talked about. In the day that strangers carried captive his forces, when foreigners entered his gates and cast lots for Jerusalem, even you were as one of them. So again, the time setting of Obadiah is the future. It's the day of the Lord. Okay, when we see these synonymous things that are happening. Okay? So it was translated again as a future event, though it's already happened. It's this prophetic past tense. But he says it was the same as if you had been there alongside this invading army. Okay, so they're going to stand by while their brother was being taken to slavery, and then they're going to rejoice. Like he says in verse 12, you should have not gazed on the day of your brother in the day of his captivity, nor should you have rejoiced over the children of Judah in the day of their destruction, nor should you have spoken proudly in the day of distress. Again, when we start realizing that, you know, all these people in the region are descendants, and we look at their modern day attitude towards Israel, oh, they're going to be overjoyed and gleeful at the fact that Israel, quote unquote, is getting its comeuppance, that, you know, they're being overrun, they're being taken over after so many years being a thorn in the side of all the people in their mind in the Middle East. And so, yeah, this is not a stretch to see this happening and coming to fruition here in the near future. So then verse 13, it says, you should not have entered the gate of my people in the day of their calamity. Indeed, you should have not gazed on their affliction in the day of their calamity, nor laid hands on their substance in the day of their calamity. And then verse 15, we see, for the day of the Lord upon all the nations is near. As you have done, it shall be done to you. Your reprisal shall return upon your own head. So what you did is going to come back upon you. Again, all part of the prophecies that we're talking about. And it's not only just you, but it's on all nations, okay, that have been doing wrong. Again, so we see here that this change from Edom to all nations, right? Again, it seems to be representative of all the nations, especially in the region. Okay, they're all his descendants. But you know, you have the people of God and you have the people that are not of God. And that's basically, you know, the Israelis, the Israelites, and the Gentiles. And again, that's the way the whole Bible is divided up. God's people and not God's people yet. Nonetheless, it says, okay, we see this happening in the day of the Lord. This is a setting for this prophecy in Obadiah, which is paralleling the prophecies that we're reading in Amos 1. So back to Amos 1 and verse 12. It says, but I will send a fire upon Teman, which shall devour the places of Bozrah. And again, we see then that God is going to send a fire, not set on fire, but send a fire that will devour. Okay, it's going to devour the palaces, in this case, of Bozrah. So we have Teman, right? And Teman is the grandson of Esau, who, again, we trace a lot of their lineage through the Ottomans, like the Ottoman Empire, but Ottoman is very similar to Teman here in terms of we're going to try to follow who these peoples are. But in Obadiah, I should have had you hold your places there, but in Obadiah 1 in verse 18, now we come to the Bible interpreting the Bible. And again, as we go through this, okay, through Obadiah 1, verse 18, we know that this is the day of the Lord, and it's showing what the fire is going to be here. It says, the house of Jacob shall be a fire, and the house of Joseph a flame, but the house of Esau shall be stubble or straw. They shall kindle them and devour them, and no survivor shall remain of the house of Esau, for the Lord has spoken. So we see then Israel's complete triumph over Esau, or the people of Edom here. And God uses the same words with Obadiah here in terms of fire and devour in verse 18, as he uses for fire and devour in Amos 1, in talking about sending a fire. Okay, and this is why we're trying to make the distinction between send a fire, which is kind of, it's not terminology that we would commonly use, as opposed to set on fire. So if you're going to set on fire, I mean, to me, if I'm going to go to a city and I'm going to use fire to destroy it, I'm going to set it on fire. But God talks about sending a fire, not to say that he can't send a fire that causes them to be burnt up either, but the terminology seems to be very specific in this sense. And when we look at Obadiah, verse 18, it says that the house of Jacob shall be a fire. So God's going to use this fire to destroy Edom, as it's talking about here in Amos 1, and they are going to be devoured. Right? This is how God's going to do it. And the timing is the day of the Lord. It's the end time. So God delivers them here in this end time. They're going to be like fire against straw. They're going to be completely consumed. There's not going to be any survivors of this nation. And what that means is like it's going to be as though they had never been. They're going to be cut off, and they're going to be cut off forever. Now, exactly what that means, okay, I'm not going to get into it to a great degree, but we do know that they will come back, that God always gives everybody their first chance at salvation, to know him, to have his spirit. So they will be afforded a chance in the second resurrection. And also, if we want to be technical about it, once you have God's Spirit, you're no longer a Gentile. You're no longer of any other nation. You are of Israel. You are of the Israel of God that Galatians 6 talks about. And Romans 2 says that once you have God's Spirit, then you are a spiritual Jew, a spiritual Israelite. So again, you move from that. So yes, is Edom going to be cut off? Yes, in at least more than one way, they will be. And so we see then that God's going to send this fire in the end time. And so it is a way of again, letting the Bible interpret the Bible. But again, it may be also a play on words, and it could be that he's going to use both. And we'll see that here in just a second. So back to Amos 1, in verses 13 through 15, now we see the pronouncement against Ammon. It says, Amos 1:13, thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of the people of Ammon, and for four, I will not turn away its punishment, because they ripped open the women with the child in Gilead, that they might enlarge their territory. Again, we see this horrible practice that was presumably to control the population of the enemy, make sure that it doesn't grow, that they die. And that's it is so barbaric that even, as we mentioned before, that the king back then, or the king-to-be, Hazael, was just mortified that this was prophesied of him, that he would do it. So not only did he do it, but it looks like the people of Ammon, which are modern-day Jordan, are going to do this thing, or did do this thing as well, to, again, enlarge that territory. Again, this is why I said, go look at where Jordan is and Gilead, and you see that it is part of modern-day Jordan, that area. And then verse 14, he says, I will kindle a fire in the wall of Rabbah, and it shall devour its palaces amid shouting in the day of battle and a tempest in the day of whirlwind. So now, Rabbah is the city of Ammon, in Jordan. It's the same exact location. Ammon is in the same exact location that ancient Rabbah used to be in. And so we see this continuity here of thought. And it goes on, it says, amid shouting in the day of battle. Now the word here for shouting is teruah. That's also the name for the day of trumpets, is Yom Teruah, the day of shouting. Okay, so it's interesting that during the day of the Lord, the day of the Lord is comprised, it's the seventh seal, which is comprised of seven trumpets, okay? And then the seventh trump, the final trump, is going to be composed of then seven plagues. And that all these things are going to be happening during that time. To me, it's further confirmation. Now look at Jeremiah 49, verse 2. Jeremiah 49, verse 2. I just wanted to put this in here to finish off this thought about what it means to send a fire. Jeremiah 49, verse 2, it says, therefore, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will cause to be heard an alarm. The word there is teruah, again, this shout of war, this alarm of war in Rabbah of the Ammonites. So in Rabbah, in the land of Ammon, it shall be a desolate mound, and her villages shall be burned with fire. Then Israel shall take possession of his inheritance, says the Lord. So again, here we see, it looks like, okay, that Israel's going to come in and take possession, and they're going to burn with fire as well. So again, they are the fire. It's going to be burnt with fire. It's either both of them or a combination of the two. Nonetheless, we see then that it comes back to, I mean, it's by God, the power of God, and it could have then this double meaning. And then finally, verse 15, their king shall go into captivity, he and his princes together, says the Lord. Again, I should have kept you there in Jeremiah 49, verse 3. It says, howl, O Heshbon, for Ai is spoiled. Cry, you daughters of Rabbah. Gird with sackcloth, lament, and run to and fro by the hedges, for the king shall go into captivity, and his priests and his princes together. So again, we see then Jeremiah 49, 2 and 3, very closely paralleling Amos 1, verses 14 and 15. And then we'll find here in chapter 2 next time that there's still yet one more pronouncement to be made against another place. And we'll sum it up after that. But nonetheless, what we see here then is a prophecy, again, which may have had fulfillments in the past. But again, when we know God in the intricacies of what he's doing in the prophecies and how people really don't change. And again, maybe that's the commentary for all prophecy and so much of prophecy being dual, is that they have not learned the lessons of the past, so they're doomed to repeat them in the future. And God is just saying ahead of time, if you do these things, this is what's going to happen, and this is what's going to happen, so I'm going to do these things.